When I was commissioned, there were approximately 220 African-American officers in the Navy. The senior officer was Commander Dave Parham, a Navy chaplain. The senior line officer was Lieutenant Commander Samuel L. Gravely. While in flight training, only one African-American made it through the program. In fact, I had only seen two African-American officers while in training. My first duty station was at Naval Air Station Barbers Point in Hawaii. When we got to Hawaii, there were perhaps as many as 20 African-American officers. Lieutenant Commander Gravely was there and had command of the USS Theodore E. Chandler. My friend and neighbor, Ensign Gordon Fisher, introduced me to Lieutenant Commander Gravely, and I was able to spend a day at sea with him on the Chandler. Also in Hawaii was Lieutenant Commander Wesley Brown, Civil Engineer Corps, the first African-American to graduate from the United States Naval Academy. Captain Frank Peterson, United States Marine Corps, was a senior African-American pilot in the Marine Corps, later promoted to Lieutenant General, Marine Corps. Lieutenant Commander Gravely was a giant of a man and a longtime hero. Knowing what I went through in flight training, for him to be successful must have been extremely difficult, and he had my instant admiration and respect. We never served together, but each time I saw him, he made time to mentor me. I was so impressed with the Admiral that I hung his official Navy painting in my office when I was the Assistant Secretary of the Navy. And one of my career highlights while the Acting Secretary of the Navy was inviting my friend, Admiral Paul Reason, the first African-American to attain 4 stars, to speak at the commissioning of the USS Gravely, DDG 107. This was the first time an African-American Secretary of the Navy had the opportunity to invite a 4-star African-American Admiral, Paul Reason, to speak at the commissioning of a Navy warship named after the first African-American to become Admiral in the United States Navy. It is now my pleasure to introduce you to Dr. Roslyn M. Brock, a nationally recognized health policy advocate, social justice change agent, noted public speaker, and youth leadership mentor. She holds the distinct honor of being the youngest person and 4th woman unanimously elected to the role of board chairman for the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. Dr. Brock is founder and CEO of Equity Partnership Strategies, a racial equity consulting firm that provides strategic consultation to corporate boards, executive leadership teams, nonprofit organizations, and institutions on community engagement, investment, and risk mitigation. She graduated magna cum laude from Virginia University. She earned a master's degree in health services administration from the George Washington University, a MBA from the Kellogg School of Management at Northwestern University, and a master's degree in divinity from the Samuel DeWitt Proctor School of Theology at Virginia Union University. She holds 4 honorary doctorate degrees. Dr. Brock has numerous awards and honors, too many to mention in the time Admiral Maslow has allotted me. We are on the board of trustees at the George Washington University together. Dr. Brock's personal philosophy is embodied in an African proverb: care more than others think is wise. Risk more than others think is safe. Dream more than others think is practical. And expect more than others think is possible. She also serves as associate minister at the historic Alfred Street Baptist Church in Alexandria, Virginia. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Roslyn Brock.
Thank you, BJ, for your kind introduction, and let me extend my welcome to all of you who are joining today live or someday in the future on YouTube as we discuss a man who I'm proud to say is an alum of my beloved alma mater, Virginia Union University, that traces its origin back to 1899 with the merger of two small colleges that rose up at the conclusion of the Civil War. He was also a member of the NAACP, the nation's oldest and largest civil rights organization that I've had the privilege to serve on its board as its national chairman and a member for more than 35 years. Vice Admiral Samuel L. Gravely Jr. graduated nearly 40 years ahead of me at Virginia Union University, the culmination of his life's work as the first African-American to reach the rank of Admiral in the United States Navy epitomizes Virginia Union's mantra that prepares its students for the promise of a limitless future. In his own words, Vice Admiral Gravely understood the pressures on him at every stage of his career when he wrote, "I was sure that I could not afford to fail. I thought that would affect other members of my race if I failed anywhere along the line. I was always conscious of that, particularly in midshipman school and any other schools I went to. I tried to set a record of perfect attendance ashore and at sea." The November 1979 issue of the NAACP Crisis Magazine has a story entitled "New Spirit of the Navy," written by NAACP National President Dr. Montagu Cobb. The article reports on a breakfast meeting hosted by Vice Admiral James D. Watkins, Chief of Personnel of the United States Navy, on July the 2nd, 1976, in Memphis, Tennessee. The meeting was held with NAACP leaders to share that the Navy had launched additional efforts to expand opportunities for minorities to ensure that equal opportunity is available at every level of naval operations. Vice Admiral Gravely, who was a rear admiral at the time, also attended the breakfast with two other rear admirals. During the meeting, he acknowledged publicly that the Navy had not pushed the advancement program as vigorously as it might, and stated that he strongly desired the advice and assistance of the NAACP in achieving their mutual goals. His candor and honesty on this issue so impressed the NAACP leadership that they pledged their full support and cooperation to help the Navy achieve their goals of expanding opportunities for minorities. This partnership led to orientation programs at the U.S. Naval Academy for minority high school and junior high school age students, with the first orientation class of 24 boys and girls held on September the 3rd, 1979. It is my great honor, it was my great honor to meet Vice Admiral Gravely during my tenure at the NAACP. He was a very stately yet humble man. I will never forget that he was no nonsense, matter of fact, as he shared his life story with the group. To me, he was a living legend with a strong commitment to excellence and public service. He understood firsthand that racism exists, but he challenged those who looked to him for leadership not to use it as an excuse for not trying to do something to improve themselves. Today, we have an opportunity to hear the incredible story of his life, how he broke down barriers of racial discrimination, and how he inspired others to achieve their personal dreams. Vice Admiral Gravely believed, "Your legacy is the difference you make in others' lives." And what a lasting memory of honor and pride he's left for generations of young men and women at the U.S. Navy. Let me now turn over this over to Rear Admiral Sonny Masso, who will introduce our guest speakers and commentators.
Good morning. I'm Sonny Masso, the Executive Director of the Naval Historical Foundation, and welcome to Second Saturday for February 2021. Thank you, Secretary Penn and Ms. Brock, for your kind introductory remarks. The subject for today's Second Saturday is an inspiring individual, the first African-American to attain command at sea, indeed the first African-American to make flag rank, and become a numbered fleet commander, commanding the United States Third Fleet, then homeported in Hawaii, retiring after a shore tour as a vice admiral. Of course, we're talking about Vice Admiral Samuel L. Gravely. To cover Vice Admiral Gravely's career, our staff historian, Dr. Dave Winkler, who had been commissioned by Vice Admiral Gravely at the NROTC unit at Penn State back in 1980, chatted with Dr. Regina Akers of the Naval History and Heritage Command and Paul Stillwell, long of the United States Naval Institute and recipient of our 2019 Commodore Dudley W. Knox Medal for Lifetime Achievement within the Naval History profession. Both are noted oral historians as recognized last year by a Mid-Atlantic Oral History Organization with its Forrest Pogue Award for Lifetime Achievement. Both have written extensively. Dr. Aker's most recent written work, The Navy's First Enlisted Women, Patriotic Pioneers, can be downloaded at the Naval History and Heritage Command's website. Meanwhile, the number of titles that Paul Stillwell has published over the years are too numerous to mention. But germane to this program is his Golden 13, covering the recruitment of the Navy's first 13 African-American officers, and an autobiographical work that Paul helped author with the Vice Admiral. It is my pleasure to announce that as part of this Second Saturday project, we sat down with Vice Admiral Gravely's 99-year-old widow, Alma, for what turned out to be an extraordinary interview that we're going to feature in our forthcoming weekly Thursday Tidings, which is an e-letter that we send to our members. Of course, to get Thursday Tidings, you have to be a member, and to do that, all you need to do is go to our www.navyhistory.org website and sign in. It's that easy. Following this presentation, I'll be back, and Regina and Paul will rejoin us along with Secretary Penn and a dear friend, Rear Admiral Julius Caesar, to add further reflections on Vice Admiral Gravely and to take your questions. Special thanks are extended to our sponsors, the National Naval Officers Association, under the superb leadership of Rear Admiral Sinclair Harris, and a gift from former Navy Lieutenant and member of the Naval Academy Class of 1976, John Carwile. Now, on to the program. Enjoy.
We used to have a pamphlet at the museum, the National Museum for the Navy in the Navy Yard. It's considered the flagship museum. That was about African-Americans, and there was an error in there. It noted that Admiral Gravely's first ship was the Fowlget, and it was actually the Theodore E. Chancellor. And so the deputy director at the time, and I apologize, I don't remember who that was, but he said to me, we need to address this, and we'd like you to go talk to Admiral Gravely. And so he was with an engineering firm at the time, retired. This was in 88, I think. And so I went out to his office, and he was very generous to give me about 45 minutes of his time. And I'll never forget, he was very careful to walk a tight line about what his experiences were like without being too negative about the Navy or its policies. And so as we were coming to an end, I said, sir, can you be a little bit more specific about, you know, the racism and discrimination that you encountered? And he paused and he said, okay, sit down. I'll give you a few more minutes. And then he went on to tell me about naval personnel who would cross the street instead of saluting him. Then he would tell me about going to the Naval War College. And once they realized he was a Black officer coming to the War College, he and his wife actually had to stay over a night in their car. Then he would tell me about different places he was stationed and whatever progress the Navy was making towards integration, he had to deal with societal norms, which was a segregated America for a long time. And so they couldn't get a hotel. That's one reason why she wasn't with him and at his early duty stations, because the locals would not let him rent a house, would not let him get an apartment.
I first became aware of Commander Sam Gravely in 1966 when I was a fresh-caught ensign. I was in Coronado, California to take amphibious warfare training before heading to my first ship, which was over in the Western Pacific and operating in the Vietnam War. So one day in the summer, I went to a Navy barber shop on the base. There was not a chair available right away. So while I was waiting, I picked up a copy of Ebony magazine. And as I paged through it, I came across an article on Commander Sam Gravely, had some great pictures with it. This was an absolute revelation to me. I had no idea that there was a black commanding officer of a destroyer in the U.S. Navy. And Gravely told me later that he very reluctantly took the reporter and the photographer on board. He did not like to blow his own horn, but he was forced to by the Office of Information. So they collected the information, and it turned out to be a beautiful article.
He loved sports. As a child, he played tennis and football. In fact, Paul may have mentioned this, he initially wanted to be a football coach, a high school football coach. He enjoyed sports very much, especially, as I said, tennis and football, playing in the local parks and things. His father, by the way, was a World War I Army veteran and was a pullman with the Southern Railroad. So just think about that for a minute at the time in which he was living and what impact that might have had. The family attended the Rising Mount Zion Baptist Church. Admiral Gravely's mother allowed him to attend school year round. Paul may have mentioned that, which made him each year he was ahead of his class. Consequently, he went off to college quite as a young man, younger than 18, which is 17, 18 is the average age. He loved school. He thrived on it. He did very well in school. His mother sadly died at the age of 15. And so when it was time to go off to college, he always wanted to go to Hampton University in Virginia. However, his father, as I said, he's the first of, so there were younger siblings, to support his father in helping to raise the other kid, his siblings, he decided to go to Virginia Union. It was just a practical decision to better support his dad. And that's where he was. He'll work for a while before he decides to go into the service. And that was primarily driven by a couple things. One, his passion and patriotism, which just strengthened following the attack on the United States at Hawaii, the Japanese attack at Pearl Harbor on 7 December. Also, this would be about the spring of 42 that he's making this decision. At that time, the Navy's general board had meant to expand opportunities for blacks, and he was aware of that. Another issue, believe it or not, was his father's World War I Army service. His father never described it as being terrific, outstanding, or whatever. And he figured, if I go in the Navy, I'll be in a dry bunk and I'll eat. I won't be in a trench, so to speak. And he talks about this in several post-retirement interviews that he did. And that's what led him to the Navy versus the Army. And he also realized that if he enlisted, he was making a decision which service to be in. You and I have both talked to veterans who would say, I want to be in the Navy, and then they see you the other way and you're in the Army, right? And so he wanted to make that decision.
Sam Gravely was commissioned in late 1944, which was about 9 months after the Golden 13 became officers. And the Navy had plans to send him back to Great Lakes to supervise training of black recruits. And he had the feeling that this was not really the Navy. He wanted to be in the seagoing Navy. And that was a trait that stuck with him throughout his entire career. He managed to get orders to a submarine chaser, the PC-1264. And before that, he went to sub Chaser School in Miami, Florida. And among the indignities he had in the South was that he was arrested by military policemen for impersonating a commissioned officer. And even though he showed them his ID card, he was hauled away in a paddy wagon. And his skipper, a very enlightened man, Lieutenant Eric Purdon, came to bail him out of jail with the promise that he would keep his sailors ashore during the remainder of their time in Charleston. And so Gravely was reinstated to the ship. It might be worth mentioning that Gravely was the first Black officer to serve on board a combatant ship of the U.S. Navy. PC 1264 had an anti-submarine mission. He started off as the engineer, later fleeted up to become communication officer, and by the end, he was the executive officer. And he and the skipper, Eric Purdon, maintained a great bond through their service together.
During World War II, the seeds for integrating our armed forces were planted. They grew slowly, but they were planted. And so there'll be a couple of key milestones from World War II forward in this process of the military becoming more integrated and ending discrimination. So one example of this is President Harry S. Truman will issue Executive Order 9981. And that's important because he is mandating equality of treatment in the military, regardless of race, creed, color, et cetera. Key initiative. This was also an election year. Sometimes things are possible during an election year that otherwise are not. I wish we had more time to talk about that, but that was an election year. The other thing to keep in mind is that the United States in after World War II had started or declared an unspoken, undeclared war with Russia. And that Cold War will go on for some five decades from there, ending under the Bush administration, Bush the Elder, President Bush. One of the first tests of this new approach to new policy of stopping discrimination, expanding opportunity, would be the Korean War.
He had been done with the Navy after World War II, and he said, I left because nobody asked me to stay. So he went to school, finished his degree, and he worked in a railway post office because his father told him that that would give him job security. His father had worked in the post office. But fate intervened in 1949. Navy was now much more proactive in trying to get Black officers into the Navy and Black enlisted men as well. So he was recalled to active duty as a recruiter in 1949 with the idea that it would be a one-year tour of duty. Well, the Korean War came along in 1950, so the 1 year stretched into 31 years before he finally left active duty. His first ship was the battleship Iowa, which was participating in the Korean War. He was assigned to communications, the radio officer on board the Iowa. He had two skippers, Captain Bill Smedberg, Captain Joshua Cooper. Both of them welcomed him. Cooper even more so, made sure that he was made to feel comfortable. He was not universally liked among the wardroom, but a number of white officers did reach out. He had a white roommate, and the wives of the officers reached out to Alma, his wife, and had a special lunch for her and just made her feel welcome aboard. So he got a sense of comfort, did his job well, and laid the groundwork for further assignments in the Navy.
For African Americans, this period was a tough one because, again, going back to the 40s so we can understand this, much like after World War I, there was what we historians call a return to normalcy. Whatever progress the military was making towards ending segregation, expanding equal opportunity, the military is a segment of society. So whatever the conditions were on a base, once that individual, that African-American left the base, they had to adjust to the customs and practices and laws that reflected racial standards and norms in society at large. That did not change. So one of the highlights in the longtime civil rights movement in this country was the Montgomery bus boycott, starting December of 55, when Rosa Parks, a seamstress and NAACP worker, National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, refused to give up her seat, and that launches a bus boycott, which was very successful. It also will begin to raise the prominence of an already a new graduate, actually, from graduate school, one young Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., whose intent at the time, quite frankly, was to just be the pastor of his granddaddy's church. That's what he hoped to do. But the local NAACP chapter president persuaded him initially to speak to those who were involved in this bus boycott. And then his role grew. His name was Nixon. His role grew. And then there's him and all the others who came with him, the Jesse Jacksons, if you will, the Andrew, and those folks, his lieutenants, who would go on to distinguish themselves as well later on. But for African American, progress was slow. And just to give us one example of this, and how it came, it shadowed the 50s and 60s that you asked about. In the late 60s, 68, I believe it was, the All Hands did a feature on the Navy's four Black 06s, four Black captains. One was Gravely, and one was Thomas Parham, who was one of our first Black captains, commissioned during World War II. But four, think about that for a minute, four Black captains. There wasn't a woman Black captain. That wouldn't happen until the early 80s. So progress was being made, but up until World War II, there was a historical practice of recruit African Americans, retain them, and release them. Again, after World War II, that practice is going to be interrupted by initial steps to integrate African Americans and give them opportunities.
After Admiral Gravely got more senior, he had been stuck in sort of second-class citizens' jobs, which was essentially the policy of the Bureau of Personnel at the time. The idea was keep them in a communications specialty or recruiting or something like that, and then they won't have enough experience in the broad naval profession to go beyond lieutenant commander. So Lieutenant Commander Gravely took the ball in his hands and moved it forward. He volunteered for an executive in training program, executive officer, and this involved going from one destroyer to another, following the movements of the executive officers and getting seat time, training, how to work with the crew, and so forth. The upshot was that he then got assigned to a operating destroyer as executive officer, the Theodore E. Chandler. Gravely did well as the executive officer, developed a good bond with the skipper. The ship went into the yard for repairs and renovation. The regular skipper left, so Gravely fleeted up to be acting commanding officer. So that led to a further assignment. His first full-fledged command at sea, which was a destroyer escort named the Falgett. Commander Gravely was invited to the White House to take part in a 100th anniversary celebration of Abraham Lincoln issuing the Emancipation Proclamation on January 1st, 1963. He got to meet President John Kennedy, he met Lyndon Johnson, and he was sort of in awe of the all the talent, the African Americans who had been invited to this celebration of something that had happened during the Civil War and made a profound difference in the lives of so many citizens. His next command duty was on board a destroyer, a World War II, 6.5-inch guns, USS Taussig, and she was sent to Vietnam, and she was involved in plane guarding for aircraft carriers. The ship also did shore bombardment of the coast of South Vietnam to protect American troops. He stayed for more than his allotted time of 2 years. He was selected for captain, and the Commodore didn't want two captains in the same squadron, but Gravely was happy doing what he did and just stayed until he finally got further orders. Sam Gravely's third sea command was the USS Jewett, which was state-of-the-art, top-of-the-line anti-aircraft Captain Gravely had gone ashore from the Jewett at one point, and when he came back to the ship, the men on the quarterdeck rang six bells, ding, 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 ding. Normally for a captain, the sequence is four bells, ding, 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 ding. And so his first thought was the quarterdeck watch has screwed up. When he got aboard, he found out that he had been selected for rear admiral, lower half, and he was absolutely thrilled because all those days and nights at sea that he had put in, had invested in doing something he enjoyed, paid off, and he became the first Black flag officer in the history of the United States Navy.
For an African American to reach the rank of Rear Admiral, I don't know who might have even envisioned that at that time. And you, again, you're right, the year was 1971. Think about that. There's an anti-war movement in society. The women's rights movement is more intensified. The Black rights movement is more intensified. The anti-government movement. I mean, there's a lot of things going on in the 60s. There's a reason why it's called the Radical 60s. And Admiral Gravely is selected to be the Navy's first African-American admiral. This achievement was just tremendous. And it gave a sense of pride, not only to African-Americans, but other people of color, non-whites who were serving in the military. Also, if we contextualize this, this was also during the tenure of CNO, Chief of Naval Operation Elmo R. Zumwalt Jr. I mentioned about the country becoming anti-military, anti-war. So he has a couple of challenges. One, as our CNOs do today, how do you modernize the Navy and so that it can be prepared for the challenges that are ahead and also maintain the fleet that you have? He had other personnel challenges. And he decided that one of his key agenda items would be making the Navy a better place to serve, improving the quality of life for the average sailor. How did he do this? Well, he decided he was going to issue the famous Z-grams. Z-gram 66 was to increase equal opportunity for women in the Navy and to expand those opportunities. And people thought he was crazy, not just with these Z-grams, but all of them, because Zumwalt was changing their Navy. The initiatives that Zumwalt had, that context, but that in no way diminishes all that Admiral Gravely did to achieve that. In fact, he would advocate, he was a real advocate for education, that you never stop learning and you have to be determined to succeed. And so, yes, there was the change that Admiral Zumwalt was starting. And be clear, These changes are changing the culture of the Navy and how it operates. I can't emphasize that enough. What are we talking about today, right, with Task Force One? Changing the culture of the Navy. And Admiral Zumwalt was doing that, but Admiral Gravely had done the things that were necessary to qualify when that opportunity became available. And one of the things he was wonderful at was mentoring others, including many who didn't look like him, to tell them the same thing. Maybe you have a hard-ass boss now, but don't let that boss deter you from doing the best job possible, because one day you're going to get your chance, and you don't want to not qualify because your work, you weren't known for doing excellent work in spite of. And I think that's a rich part of his legacy. In spite of all the racism and discrimination he encountered, he remained patriotic, he remained determined, and he understood that he was a role model even before he made the rank of Rear Admiral.
His first job was as a director of Naval Communications. After he was in the communication billet, he went to sea again, this time as Commander Cruiser Destroyer Group 2, which was based in the Atlantic. And now he was in charge of a group of ships instead of just one, as he had been before. He went from there to be Commandant of the 11th Naval District in San Diego. He and his wife had really liked their previous tours in San Diego, enjoyed going back there. He was essentially an administrative commander for all the Navy in Southern California and to some states east of there. For years, the Naval District Commandant job had been considered a twilight tour, that the officer would fulfill that tour of duty and then retire. But in 1976, lightning struck again, and he was picked for a third star. Now he was the first vice admiral in the history of the U.S. Navy. He was assigned to be Commander Third Fleet, based in Hawaii. So he was involved in setting doctrine, monitoring the fleet, and training the warships that were going to head out to the 7th Fleet in the Western Pacific. So he excelled in that job, came ashore for one more last tour, the Defense Communications Agency, and now he was in charge of all the communications, Army, Navy, Marine Corps, and keeping them all in line within the Department of Defense. And he did that for a couple of years, and finally, it was time for him to retire to Haymarket, Virginia, to spend a lot more time with his wife, Alma. After his retirement from the Navy, Admiral Gravely and his wife lived in a house in Haymarket, Virginia, and he took it easier for a while, and then he got involved in a couple of jobs in the civilian sector, and then he had a long tenure with the Armed Forces Communications and Electronics Association, much more commonly known as AFCEA. After time passed, Admiral Gravely ran into a number of health problems, particularly kidney failure. And in the latter part of his life, he had to undergo dialysis for hours at a time, 3 days a week. There was a celebration of Admiral Gravely's career at the Officers Club on the North Island Naval Air Station in Coronado, and dozens of Black naval officers who had, in a sense, used Admiral Gravely's career as a role model, who had followed after what he had established as a viable career path. And he and Alma sat on stools, and it was essentially a receiving line as one person after another filed past to express thanks and gratitude for how much he had done in his career to enable them to have careers.
You never stop learning. You should constantly desire to learn more. If you think that you know your job that well, then you're in trouble. So if you can do the job, if your boss gives you a week and you can do it in 3 days, he was okay with that. But Admiral Gravely would argue, did you do it in 3 days at the same level of excellence that you would have normally done it? Or did you just rush to do it in 3 days to please your boss? He was always about pursuing excellence, doing your very best, continuing to learn your craft, and raising others as you rise through the ranks.
Welcome back to our live program. Thanks to all the panelists. I regret that Dr. Akers won't be able to join us for the discussion phase after all, but thank you speakers for your illuminating and wonderful treatment of a great man's life. This is the part of the show where we'll feature your questions, and I want to thank many of you already for asking questions and sharing anecdotes, which I hope to get to almost each and every one. I'd like to thank again the National Naval Officers Association and Mr. John Carwile from the Naval Academy Class of 76 for their sponsorship. Our panelists this morning are historian Paul Stillwell, whom you just saw in the previous pre-recorded part, as well as Secretary BJ Penn and Rear Admiral Julius Caesar. Rear Admiral Caesar, the first salvo goes out to you. You had a minor family connection to Vice Admiral Gravely. Would you explain it and talk about your beloved mother, now an angel in heaven, and her keeping you motivated toward naval service by using Sam Gravely as the motivator?
Well, thank you, Sonny. Appreciate being here and being able to deliver a few remarks. I grew up in Cleveland, and but we came from a town called Radford, Virginia, in Southwest Virginia, and that's where Ms. Gravely is from. I had no idea of how close some of our family was, and the fact that she went to school with my father and knew my father growing up, as well as my mother. One of the things that is impactful for me although we had that connection, and I think a lot of you have been in Navy will understand why, I admired him from afar because he made it easy for me to go into the Navy. I think it was mentioned earlier, he made flag in 1971. I joined the Navy in 1972. And up until that time, it was still very difficult for African Americans to this stigma of them joining the Navy was still pretty high for a lot of reasons. But with the family connection to Admiral Gravely, it made it easier for my parents and my mother in particular to see that the Navy was fair in the fact that if they knew Admiral Gravely, knew who he was, knew his family, it was okay for their 17-year-old son to join the Navy. And Admiral Gravely opened up the door for me. So if you look back in history, he made flag in 1971. It was very well known. I graduated, entered the Navy in 1972. And also my mother kept a lot of articles and sent them to me. There's a couple that you see there. Now, as a seaman apprentice, seaman recruit, I got the number. We didn't have cell phones and conference calls and things like that. My parents gave me Admiral Gravely the number to call. So was a seaman recruit going to call up an admiral? Heck no. So... And I'd have to call him collect anyway. So, and even as a midshipman, but he made that path open for me My class was the largest class, diverse class, to go into the Naval Academy. 124 of us came in the Naval Academy, African-American males. 63 of us graduated. And if it wasn't for him and his trailblazing and being a role model, that never would have happened.
Thank you, Admiral Caesar. For Paul Stillwell, thank you for sharing the great story of reading about Admiral Gravely or then Sam Gravely in Ebony Magazine, but and sharing how you first acquired his acquaintance in a manner of speaking. But do you have some stories you wanted to share about your experiences from both his funeral services?
Yes, Sonny. I mentioned earlier he had the health problems. He died in 2004. He had two funerals. The first one was at his local church in Haymarket. It was an overflow crowd. I remember that I had to watch from the basement where there was a TV feed because there were so many people in the church who wanted to pay their respects. And the moment that most touched me was when Rear Admiral Mac Gaston got up to talk. He and I subsequently became friends, a wonderful person. As an African-American, he, as an ensign, happened to be on board a ship that was moored next to Sam Gravely's tossing. He said he got up early in the morning and went topside so he could talk to Admiral Gravely when the Admiral, or he was then a commander, when he came out on deck. And his patience was rewarded. He greeted Commander Gravely. They exchanged small talk. He reached across the lifelines and shook hands with Commander Gravely. And he said later at the funeral, it was like touching the hand of God. Subsequently, he had another funeral at Fort Myer with burial at Arlington National Cemetery. The presiding official at the burial was Rear Admiral Barry Black, then the Navy's Chief of Chaplains, an African-American. He had the gift to be able to recite long passages of scripture at great length. And if Sam Gravely had the hand of God, Barry Black had the voice of God. And you felt that a higher power was speaking to you in extolling the virtues of Sam Gravely.
Thank you, sir. And Barry Black is an exceptionally talented and gifted person filled with the Holy Spirit. It's amazing. It's wonderful that you shared that. Secretary Penn, and we refer to you as Secretary because it's your highest rank attained in your 40-year plus service, naval service. But speaking to you by your call sign, Super Bad, and as an A6 Avenger pilot, did you as an aviator keep close track on Sam Gravely's career as he was climbing the ladder towards his designated flag? And also in the moment, did you see this promotion coming?
From the time I heard of and had the opportunity to meet the, Sam Gravely, Admiral Gravely, yes, he was always a milestone, someone you attained, you wanted to achieve to be as, to be like. He was the shining light that we all wanted to attain. And at the time, there were only about 200 officers in the Navy, so we knew everyone. Knew who you wanted to emulate, who was going to be successful, and go as far as they could. When I came in the Navy, things were not like that. In fact, my parents said, well, maybe you can become a steward. Little did they know I'd end up where I did. But yes, Admiral Gravely was a milestone. And every time I had the opportunity to see him, to meet with him, he always had time to mentor me. Even as an aviator, he would have comments about flying airplanes. But yes, he was my hero.
Thank you, sir. So for Paul Stillwell, there's a book that has been recently, you know, reinvigorated by some of the events in society today, and that's a historian, much like Gina Akers from the Naval Historical and Heritage Command, Dr. John Sherwood, and he wrote a book, Black Sailor, White Navy, and we'll feature that book cover shortly. But you, as Admiral Gravely's biographer, did you feel his, you know, what did you feel his place was in these difficult times? Was there any evidence that suggested that senior Navy leadership reached out to him for advice and counsel? Did he have any personal feelings on some of the very egregious events that occurred in that time frame mentioned in the book?
Interestingly, he did his jobs and did them well. And when Admiral Zumwalt came along as CNO and opened the doors to further opportunity, he said he personally was not consulted. He had Admiral Zumwalt had an officer on his staff, Commander Norman, who was essentially his consultant and pushed Admiral Zumwalt to issue the Seagram 66 that became so instrumental in changing the Navy. But Gravely himself preferred just to be viewed as a naval officer, not necessarily as a black naval officer. He excelled in doing his job, doing it well, and by doing so, he created opportunities for others. He was not a person who sought out public acclaim. He sometimes went out of his way to avoid it. When we first broached the subject of a oral history for the Naval Institute, he said he wasn't interested, but I kept pushing. He finally agreed. And so I had a wonderful series starting with boyhood. He talked about his father's influence. He talked about growing up in a family in the South, how he was treated when he and Alma would cross country. They had few places to stay. One night they were at a motel in Memphis on the other side of the tracks, as he put it. There was no heat. And he and Mrs. Gravely and the two sons they had by then had to huddle together for warmth. He was able to put that aside and focus on doing the right thing.
Thank you very much. One of our foundation's dearest friends and a close friend to me personally, Tom Cutler from the United States Naval Institute, has a couple of anecdotes that I think are really sharp about not just Admiral Gravely's tenacity, his professionalism, but also his sense of humor. And he was crossing, he was the OTC, the Officer in Tactical Command, during a transatlantic crossing with a mix of ships that included a number of amphibious ships. And since this group was ahead of PIM, Admiral Gravely decided to hold some tactical maneuvering drills. And as my dear friend and mentor, Michael Jesse Worley, used to say, go to sea, go to work, kind of the same philosophy here, but he wanted to hold these tactical maneuvering drills. So some of the amphibs were apparently not used to doing anything much more than flying the guide flag, and we know about that in some cases. But they were really struggling getting on station and kind of getting to where they needed to go in this Zulu 13 Charlie event. So anyway, after one rather egregious failing with near misses and everything that went with it, and folks are out of station. It's a hot mess out there, if you can only imagine. Admiral Gravely sent a flashing light message saying simply, good. And then about a minute later, the next message was, God. So, good God. So thank you, Tom Cutler, for sharing that story. We're getting a lot of other sharings in that just talked about Jim Jackson has shared a couple of really great anecdotes. He talked about just how great Sam Gravely transformed the 11th Naval District, a very big district, you know, fleet concentration area, San Diego and Long Beach, you know, albeit maybe not quite Norfolk, but, you know, it was very challenging and sporty, because in that day, you know, you had operational issues as well as support activity kinds of issues. So Jim Jackson has an anecdote about Vice Admiral Stansfield Turner. And he had another one where, you know, he just talked about how he transformed, you know, the properties of Balboa Hospital and that, and how Admiral Gravely's work made its way even as high as President Ford and Secretary Rumsfeld. So some great sharing there. Speaking of sharing anecdotes, I want to come back to you, Admiral Caesar. And, you know, you very poignantly throughout your career, and I've known you, you know, for decades, literally. And I've heard you share this and bring people nearly to tears, depending on the type of audience. But if you could share the story of your personal reflections, seeing Admiral Gravely's photograph on the Navy leadership picture boards. And how did this inform your own thoughts and demeanor as later you would be on those picture boards? Do you mind sharing those thoughts with the group?
Sure. I think you saw some of those articles that came up. My mother sent me clippings of Admiral Gravely when he was captain, just made flag. I still have those clippings today from the 70s. And one of those said, "Enlisted man rose to top Navy rank." And I enlisted to go in. I said I wanted to be like that. One of the things that when I was in boot camp is you see all of these pictures of everybody, but they didn't look like you in the early 70s. And so I respected all of their all the things that they did, but when I saw Admiral Gravely's picture, I said, hey, that's somebody that looks like me, and if he can make it, I can make it. And as a selfish 17 or 18 year old, I said, in the Navy, I said, I want to be a picture on the wall one day, because I never seen so many damn pictures in my life of so many, so many folks, from Admiral Halsey, Nimitz. And so throughout my career, I know the impact of seeing Admiral Gravely's picture. What that did to me, a young African-American from the inner city of Cleveland. Again, I respected all the Navy leaders, but he made it such that, hey, he was a personal role model. And even in my retirement and as a commander, when I first got my picture on the wall as a CO, I said, I thought I had made it. And I said, I was just like Admiral Gravely. Little did I know a few years later that I would be a picture on the wall in the Pentagon. And Admiral Gravely impacted me a lot in that I don't have it. Colin doesn't have it. But I don't know if you can see it here, is that there's Admiral Gravely and myself when I made flag, and was a picture on the wall with him, because it was just so important that over a 30 or 40 year period that he had been such an inspiration to me. And that was very emotional, not only when I was able to stand next to a picture of him, but my actual picture in the Pentagon is right near his. So the impact of history, the impact of images on our young men and women is so very important.
Thank you so much for sharing that. So we got kind of a reflection from a retired Navy captain who's also a PhD named Roosevelt Wright. And good to hear from you today, Roosevelt. But he asked the panel, and so that's for all three of you, what steps should we take in elevating the incredible contributions and discussions about the life of Admiral Gravely within our historical technological documentation platforms? And of course, this very webinar does part of that. And Thursday Tidings, another one of our opportunities to share history. And there's some others, but is there more, and is this enough? What are your thoughts and ideas? And we'll talk to Secretary Penn and see what he thinks first.
Well, I think being Black History Month, this is certainly an appropriate topic for the country, specifically for the Navy, because this is one of our true heroes, the first in many regards in the Navy. And you should learn this from day one. Unfortunately, when I was going to school, I knew nothing about Admiral Gravely. It took me being in the Navy and actually being assigned a station in Pearl Harbor to meet him to really realize the importance of what he had done and the impact he has had. I mean, upon me personally, as Admiral Caesar said, here's someone that looks like me that's been successful. That's the real motivator. That knocks down a lot of barriers. You know you can do things if you see that. We're not there yet.
Mr. Stillwell, Paul, what do you have to say?
Well, I'd echo the Secretary's thoughts about the value of Black History Month. I don't know how many Februaries I have been invited to speak to various gatherings about Admiral Gravely and about the Golden 13. And I'd like to take this opportunity to talk more about the Golden 13. They were the first African-American officers commissioned by the U.S. Navy. In 1943, there were maybe 60,000 Black enlisted men, zero officers. The assistant to the Secretary of the Navy, Frank Knox, was Adlai Stevenson. And he wrote a memo to the Secretary saying, this is not a good situation. Not only is it bad, it looks bad. So I recommend that we have a hurry up course to commission 12 Black ensigns. And that proceeded to a program of going out to the various commands that had Black sailors. Altogether, 16 were gathered. They had a variety of backgrounds. Several had college degrees, others had some college. There were some with graduate degrees, one who had no college. A number of them were athletes. And one of the members of the group, William Sylvester White, said, I don't know, maybe the Navy thought that being big and strong and athletic gave you an edge on leadership. In any event, 16 men gathered in January 1944 at the Great Lakes Naval Training Session. It was a segregated facility called Camp Robert Smalls, named for Robert Smalls, who was a Black pilot in the Civil War who hijacked a Confederate ship and brought it over to the Union Navy. These men went through weeks of intensive training, and they took the idea that they would not compete with each other. They would share what each of them knew with the whole group, and that way they could succeed as a team. They felt they were under great pressure because if one did the numbers, by then there were still more Black sailors. It was almost as if each officer candidate was representing 10,000 enlisted men. And George Cooper of the group said, we've got to succeed because if we don't, it'll be a long time before another opportunity comes along. All 16 of them passed, but the Navy, which had factored in a 25% attrition rate, commissioned only 12 as planned. A 13th became a warrant officer, and the other three, sadly, had to remain as enlisted sailors and went back to their duties. This was not fairness in action. It was political expediency.
Thank you for sharing that story. Secretary Penn, did you want to jump on top of that one?
Fortunately, you mentioned George Cooper. His nephew is a very dear friend of mine, General Larry Gillespie. And he tells the story of how when they took the entrance exam, they scored too high. And they accused them of cheating, sign of the times. They took the exam a second time and scored even higher. So they finally accepted the test. Okay, these guys know what they're doing. We'll let them in.
That's good. Yeah, if I could,
Admiral Caesar, what do you got, sir?
Yeah. I think that there are a few things. Is one, there's an Admiral Gravely elementary school that's out in Haymarket. So every child that goes through that school will know exactly who he is. There's the Gravely group up at the Naval War College that teaches a lot of history and certainly bears his name. I'm executive director of the Naval Academy Minority Association. We reach out to all students, but he's on our website, and we discuss that as well. Certainly, in the age of social media, we can push that out more. And certainly, just having this forum that focuses on him, I think, is a step in the right direction. And if I may, I'd like to read a quote from Admiral Gravely that was on the back of my retirement ceremony that typifies what he does. And we need to get this out to a lot of our new leaders. But success in life is a result of several factors. My formula is simply education plus motivation plus perseverance. Education is paramount. Motivation. One must decide what he wants to do in life, how best to get there, and to proceed relentlessly towards that goal. Perseverance, the ability to steadfastly proceed to get to your goal despite all obstacles. It is the ability to overcome. And that's a quote from Vice Admiral Samuel L. Gravely, Jr.
Thank you very much, Admiral Caesar. I've got a small anecdote. When Vice Admiral Gravely was commander of United States Third Fleet, the Third Fleet, as I mentioned earlier, was homeported in Hawaii. And the waterfront in town was represented by Bill St. George, who was ComNav Surf Pack. And we had Admiral Dave Ramsey was, Crew Des Group 3. Alex Sinclair was Crew Des Group 5. And Haas Miller, the nuke, was Crew Des Group 1, because that's where the nukes resided back in those days. And I remember as a young first lieutenant, and this story really is an homage to the most influential person in my military career, who was my first chief, Bosun Mate Senior Chief John Allen Eichhorn. And you'll be hearing a lot, as long as I'm on these programs, you're going to always know about him. But I remember when we would go to sea, we had to have our line handlers dressed in their whites. And this one rainy, nasty, foggy sea detail in the morning, cold for San Diego, you know, the poor sailors would have to take their wet whites and wet works and everything and put them away. And so I remember that Admiral St. George, who was viewed as a very tough man as a type commander, the guy he listened to the most was the Force Master Chief, who happened to be a 6'8" African-American, also bosun mate, named Jesse Holloway. And he was kind of the law on the waterfront. And so my chief and I went to see him. And this made all the way up to Admiral Gravely, and line handlers on the entire waterfront were able to come out in their dungarees up until the point that they did their duties. Then they just laid below and went into the starboard and port breaks. But anyway, it was my own anecdote. Another one that's sort of an anecdote that leads to a question is again from Tom Cutler. And he's one of our featured panelists for our April 2nd Saturday on the Brown Water Navy in Vietnam. And Tom reflects on the time where he was at the Walbrook Maritime Academy in the inner city of Baltimore. And he invited then recently retired Admiral Gravely to put his uniform back on and speak to his young people. And he came and he gave in a very effusive and emotional and from the heart message, much like what you read, Admiral Caesar, a moment ago. And Tom suggests that when he reflects on that, he gets emotional himself. But to the panel, all three of you, do you know of other times that Admiral Gravely used the platform of his brilliant career to inspire others? We saw something from Roslyn Brock from the Board of Trustees of Virginia Union and some others. But do you have any other stories that you may want to pile on top of those? I'll start with Secretary Penn.
Whenever he had the time, he would show up at the NNOA, National Naval Officers Association conferences, local chapter meetings, and just be there to talk to the JOs, to motivate them, to answer their questions, basically on how to survive in the Navy, how to become successful. And it was always about superb performance. He was always available. I saw him as a captain. He was able to mentor me, and he did. Unfortunately, it didn't take, but he was there trying to do it.
Paul Stillwell.
Thank you, Sonny. I'd like to go back to George Cooper again of the Golden 13. Our family became so close to his family that George and his feisty wife, Peg, were almost like a second set of parents. And we respected them so much. And our son named our grandson, his middle name is Cooper, in honor of that couple. George Cooper had a mantra. He said, no matter where you have gotten in life, somebody else had to help you to get to that level. And you, in turn, owe it to those coming along after you to help them achieve their goals. And that absolutely was the philosophy of Sam Gravely. And no telling how many hundreds or thousands benefited because of the example he set, the personal mentoring, and how well he wanted others to succeed.
Admiral Caesar, anything come to mind?
Yeah. Although I had the family connection, I still thought like I was a seaman recruit whenever I saw him. And again, it was at an NNOA dinner. He had been retired, and he was walking with a cane, but everyone came up to him. But the biggest thing I remember is when he left, of how everyone just kind of naturally lined up in awe, and it was like he wanted to put palm branches down before where he was walking, because everyone was just in awe of him. But despite having what we would call now that rock star persona, he was such a humble man. That is the big thing. But everyone was in awe of him, and whether he knew it or not, of just how much he inspired everybody. But I just remember shaking as I was trying to reach out my hand to shake his hand, because he was, he was just that revered, and how everyone just naturally lined up to kind of let him walk through. And it was kind of like borrowing from Mufasa. It was great.
So Secretary Penn's story about the NNOA conference, I have one on Secretary Penn that shows that the apple didn't fall that far from the tree. But when Manson Brown, Coast Guard flag officer, was the president of NNOA, I was invited in my Navy capacity as Bupers to speak at an event, and I happened to bring scores, literally, of some of my JOs to the NNOA conference then in Portsmouth, Virginia. So they invited me to this kind of secret, they're going to have, these are JOs now, they're going to have this big event at Roger Brown's place, bar and grill and barbecue in Portsmouth, just off Effingham, if you know the neighborhood. So I go in there, and there's like 70 people at this big table. They were all crammed together, and Roger himself was in the bar at the time. And so in a back room sort of is Secretary Penn dining with his son-in-law, whose better half is Secretary Penn's lovely daughter, Emily. But Bruce Grooms had just gotten his third star, and he just put that bad boy on, and he was looking fine as he could be. So the two of them are having this little, kind of father-son-in-law chat. And I don't know that they knew who was in the next room, but anyway, I got up from my seat and I went over and invited him over. And Secretary Penn just commanded the room. He just commanded it. And he and Bruce just mentored scores of these people. And literally, and I think Manson would report that, that on critiques and that, the best part of that conference was that night. And Roger Brown asked who you were, And he became my new best friend because I am a Los Angeles Rams fan from way back. So, blessings to you, Secretary Penn, on always doing the unselfish thing for other people. So for Mr. Stillwell, for Paul, what was the, I know the Admiral got into the V-12 program and he was affiliated at UCLA and then Midshipman School in Columbia. What was the impetus behind that? And, you know, where was he kind of in sequence with the Golden 13? And how was he treated? Was he the lone black officer candidate? Can you just describe that just somewhat for the audience, please?
Yes. And before that, I'd like to feed on two other comments that were made earlier. Tom Cutler talked about the good God message when he was commander of the Cruiser Destroyer Group. In 1974, I had 4 weeks of active duty on board the Second Fleet flagship, USS Newport News, and Admiral Gravely's ships were in that same exercise safe pass from Puerto Rico to Norfolk. And so, in a sense, I have steamed with Sam Gravely, even though not in the same ship. As for Bruce Grooms, he was one of the Centennial Seven.
Yes.
There were seven, yes, nuclear sub, not all nuclear, but seven submarine skippers in the 20th century, and Bruce Grooms was one of them. And it's a pleasure that they have gone on to other things. He became a vice admiral. Mel Williams became a vice admiral. To your specific question, Sam Gravely was sort of at loose ends as an enlisted man. In 1943, he had not done as well in machinist mate school as expected. He was put into the welfare and recreation program at the Naval Base in San Diego. And this future three-star admiral was in charge of running the pool hall for the sailors to come in and shoot some pool and collect their nickels or whatever it cost. There was an officer in charge of welfare and rec, a lieutenant, and he said, "Gravely, you need to sign up for the V-12 program." And Gravely said, "What is that?" And he told him it was a two-year program that involved college education and Navy training. So Gravely went ahead and put in his application. He was selected. There had been no restriction on race concerning who could apply for this, so he got in, went to UCLA. And he had first gone to University of Southern California, but that school didn't want him, so he got switched to UCLA, the only black sailor in the program there. That led to Midshipman School in New York City. He was commissioned in December 1944, went on to the PC 1264. After my book on the Golden 13 came out, I sent Admiral Gravely an inscribed copy. And in it, the dedication, I wrote, "Congratulations to someone who followed in the footsteps of these pioneers." And his very gentle, kind, diplomatic way, Admiral Gravely got back to me and said, "Oh, by the way, I was in an officer program before they were."
That's so cool. Of course, I don't know all the names of the Magnificent Seven, but I do know Tony Watson was a surface nuke from the Naval Academy class of 70, classmate of Leo Williams, Major General, United States Marine Corps. We need to mention Cecil Haney, commander of the United States Strategic Command, 4-star. And then, of course, Mel Williams, who's the son of a Master Chief. Their book is brilliant. And also, you know, a dear friend as well as Bruce Grooms. But those come to mind as submariners. If I've forgotten anyone, fill me in on the others.
Pete Tomes.
Yeah, Pete Tomes for sure. Yes, absolutely.
Lieutenant at the War College.
And then we have, of course, the UCLA connection. You might have heard of this individual named Jackie Roosevelt Robinson, He was a Bruin Army captain, and then, you know, obviously his baseball career. So was there a specific champion behind the Golden 13? You know, was it a CNP? Was it a Senate Armed Services Committee? What was the thrust behind the momentum of that to make it happen really so quickly?
I would say there were two. One was the racial movement involving the NAACP, the National Urban League, and Eleanor Roosevelt got behind it, and she had a great influence on her husband. And this and the political pressure led to Adlai Stevenson drafting the memo that led to the Golden 13 program. So it was a combination of factors, a realization that it really looked bad not to have any Black officers.
Yes, sir. And just briefly, if you could spend the last minute each talking about any final reflections you'd like to share, because I'd like to segue to Mrs. Gravely herself and see what she has to say about a few things. Her remarks are just under 10 minutes, but we want to give her time to make it within our time frame. Let me start with you, Admiral Caesar.
Like I said, he made it possible for my parents to allow me to go into the Navy. Right? And I think that, you know, some of the things that Dr. Stillwell said and Secretary Penn, my parents didn't want me to go in the Navy and be a steward. Okay. And when that happened, and particularly with someone that they knew, everyone out there, you just never know the impact that you have on other people, and particularly in being a role model. So I'm so thankful for him. And although, again, I didn't serve with him or anything like that, I always just looked at him with awe. And I know not only did he inspire me, but all the whole cadre of flag officers that we have today, both African-American as well as all of our flag officers, he stands as a sterling example. Thank you.
Thank you. Secretary Penn, please, sir.
It was, from day one, he was a motivator. Earlier, Paul mentioned Montague Cobb. He and Secretary Watkins were very, very close, to the point that when I was 00E, the job that Bill Norman had, Dr. Cobb and Secretary CNO Watkins would have lunch together frequently. And I've noticed, from my perspective, the good leaders have people they can contact, they can talk to, that give them advice on things to do, how to do their job better. And Montague Cobb was the man that helped CNO Watkins. CNO Mullins, First Division officer, was an African-American, Bill Kelly, stories like that. These were mentors, if you will, people to help you along the way. And I think that carries over. We see how our idols do. They help others, they bring others along, and it's just kind of our nature to help others be successful. In fact, with the guys that work for me, I always tell them if I've helped them in any way, their job is to help someone else. They don't have to do anything for me, just help someone else. And I think that's what many of them are doing. Thank you.
Great, thank you very much. And of course, Bill Kelly would be Desron 5 in his major command.
Right.
And distinguished graduate from Whittier College, the college in the city that I was born, Whittier, California. Mr. Stillwell, what are your last thoughts before we see Ms. Gravely?
Well, I would just like to express my gratitude for being given the opportunity to participate in this program, and then to throw out two stray factoids. I was interviewing Admiral Gravely in the 1980s, and during a break in one of the sessions, he took me out to lunch, and as we rode in his car, I saw that he had this huge car telephone. We take cell phones for granted, but that was high tech in the 1980s. The other thing is that yesterday, February 12th, was the 112th anniversary of the founding of the NAACP. It was founded on February 12th, 1909, the 100th birthday of Abraham Lincoln.
Thank you for mentioning the NAACP, of which I'm a proud member and have been for a couple 20 years. One last story before we go to Miss Gravely, and this is about Admiral Caesar and I are at a Nats game. It's Father's Day weekend, but you know we're both just having some beers and dogs, and we were talking about Chaplain Johnny Poole, who was a classmate of mine at Ole Miss. And this gentleman turns around and he says, "Do you know Chaplain Poole?" And I'm like, "Who is this guy?" And his name was George Chomp, and he was once the head coach at the Naval Academy. But more importantly, he was the assistant coach to Woody Hayes at Ohio State. And when we introduced ourselves, he said, you're from Cleveland, right? He's talking to JC or to Admiral Caesar. And he says, "We were recruiting you." And so, of course, JC's peer group at that time would have been Cornelius Green, Brian Bashnagel, Pete Johnson, and Anthony Griffin, who had two Heisman trophies. And so I don't know who was grinning more, George Chomp or JC, but it was the eighth inning, started to rain a little bit, and his daughters said, "Dad, can we take you to the car?" And the mother says, "He's not going anywhere. He's talking to his guys, you know, who was me and JC."
But, I owe you $20 for that story, Sonny. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I mean, it would have been a different
Secretary Penn almost bought into it.
Yeah, you're in the Hall of Fame now. So go ahead and let's segue to Miss Gravely, and then I'll wrap it up after this. But you're going to love it. Don't go anywhere. This is epic.
Hello. My name is Alma Gravely, and I want to thank the Naval Historical Foundation for dedicating a second Saturday webinar to the memory of my husband, Vice Admiral Samuel L. Gravely, Jr., or Sammy, as I used to call him. I want to thank my friends BJ Penn, Dr. Brock, Paul Stillwell, and Gina Akers for telling the story of Sammy's life. And Rear Admirals Julius Caesar and Sinclair Harris for their reflections on what Sammy's life meant to them. He would have been so pleased. As a naval officer who made history, Sammy always had an appreciation of history and majored in history in college. And I commend the Naval Historical Foundation for its continuing work to share our Navy's great stories with the American public. I think my challenges most were trying to balance the husband and his job, the responsibilities that required of us, and those that we truly wanted to do anyway, and trying to be a mother to three children, and taking care. The other challenge was when the ships go overseas. So when his ship would go overseas for 6 months, we wives become a husband and a wife, and we've got all of the responsibilities then. So I think those would be the worst challenges, or partially the worst challenges. I had become my own person you know, before I married. So I drew the strength from that. But I guess it just came natural. I am very, 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 very pleased, and I know he would be too. But I know exactly, and Buddy knows too, what, and all the other naval officers know too. What he would do, though, would be to say, oh, really? You know, because that's him. Working hard and not bragging about it, but succeeding rank-wise in the Navy. I think that was his biggest challenge. I think his mother more than anything else. His mother had passed already, but I think that something about his mother kept him going. We just lived our lives the way, both of us, the way we thought we should live them. And that meant at parties, at changes of commands, with people I'm talking about, at change of commands, at cocktail parties, at dinners, and programs, and all the other things. We just lived our lives the way we were taught by our mother and fathers. And Sammy's mother died when he was 15 years old. And there were five of them, five of them in my family also, and I'm the youngest of the five. He was the oldest of the five. And he had to help train those four other siblings. So he learned a lot about life through that, but he got it from his thinking about his mother and got it from his father also, who was still living. And I think that helped us a lot. We didn't go out and march and things like that. That was not us. It still isn't me. I can't do it. Others can do it, but I can't. That's not the way I want to do it. Live my life and respect other races and have them then respect me. And he felt the same way. I tell everybody I'm so blessed because not only the one little family I have, which is only my daughter and daughter-in-law now, and relatives, the nieces and nephews, a few of them, are still living, and my neighbors and my church members and the Navy, I am very, very blessed. I hope this reflection on Sammy's life may offer all who watch this inspiration to conquer whatever challenges you may confront in your lives. Thank you for watching, and may God bless all of you.
And may God bless you, Mrs. Gravely. You are an angel on earth, and we appreciate you today. Thank you for watching our second Saturday program. I'd like to thank again the National Naval Officers Association that we really gave some serious props to today. So you need to thank us too. But love you guys. And thank you, Sinclair Harris, for your sponsorship. John Carwell, shipmate doesn't begin to describe our friendship. And the foundation's appreciation. You and St. Harris are both, by the way, life members. So for the rest of you, get on our website, navy.history.org, and join. But thank you for that. I was asked in a question from the audience what books influenced me in my own personal education, and a couple of them come to mind. The first is Juan Williams' Eyes on the Prize. Yes, the journalism journalist on Fox Network, but Eyes on the Prize is an expert treatise on the whole Southern Christian leadership movement and in that maneuvering over that space of 10 to 12 years. Others include Claude Brown's Man-Child in the Promised Land, and of course, anything written by Dick Gregory, Calluses on My Soul. There were a couple. If you're looking for something specific to Navy history, I would go no further than either Dr. Sherwood's Black Sailor, White Navy, that chronicles the challenges during the early 70s and the reforms that Admiral Zumwalt put in place by the very Z-gram that we projected earlier today to really handle with great leadership some turbulent times. If you like our content, join us. I want to thank Miss Birchie Green of the National Maritime Historical Society for promoting this event today. We were represented in 15 states, 3 countries, and we always do well with our YouTube views after the fact. It'll be posted. I want to thank our brilliant historian and really the man behind the curtain. He is the Wizard of Oz, Dr. Dave Winkler. He is just a great public servant, and if you like this program, then you need to thank him. And then finally, our production manager, my son Colin Masso, for doing this. And so, if your organization wants to do a webinar, he's the guy to call. Stay tuned next month. We're going to focus on the USS Thresher, and this is big because Freedom of Information Act requests. Lawsuits, things got settled. There's new information. You're going to hear it from the experts, and that'll be next month. And then in April, we're going to laser focus on Brown Water Navy in Vietnam, HAL 3, some really great information. So thank you for tuning in. Thanks to our panelists. You did God's work today, and this was brilliant. Thank you, and out here.